Welcome and good morning, afternoon or evening to you all, wherever in the world you may be joining us. My name is Mason Sugars and I'm a product marketing coordinator at the Sealite Group. I form part of our global marketing team. Marianne is unable to join us this evening. On behalf of the Sealite Group, I wish to thank you for joining us today for our fourth Sealite webinar. So take the opportunity to sit back and relax for the next 45 minutes or so. And this is the fourth webinar of our five-part series where we bring to you industry-leading experts across the globe. These industry experts will be sharing with you their knowledge and insights to assist you in the world of ATON and risk management. Our topic today is the role of IALA. I'm pleased to welcome Malcolm Nicholson, our Global Product Manager for Sealite. I'm even more excited to announce that we're in great company with Francis Zachariae, the Secretary General of IALA, joining us this evening. Before I pass over to Malcolm, I'll go through some housekeeping for those who are not familiar with our Zoom platform. Firstly, you can view the speaker's video today under the View Options tab at the top of your screen. Also, feel free to ask any questions during the webinar using the Q&A box. You can access it from the bottom of your screen. We'll also hold answering any of your questions until the end of the webinar presentation. I now pass to Malcolm, who will host today's webinar. We hope you enjoy it.
Thank you very much, Mason. An absolute pleasure to be here again for the fourth webinar, where it's wonderful to be joined by a good friend of mine, Francis Zachariae, and he'll be taking us through the role of IALA. Our fifth webinar will be in January, and I'll touch more on that later on. But now to Francis, what to begin? What an illustrious career he has had. He has been the Secretary General of IALA since 2015, but his roots began in the Royal Danish Naval Academy, where he spent many years there, in and out, obtaining various titles over the time. He holds a Master's of Science and the rank of Captain. He was Deputy Director of the Danish Maritime of Defence and the Danish Maritime Authority before joining IALA. He has a lot of expertise in maritime regulation, safety of navigation and pilotage, and has been pivotal in IALA's changing role from NGO to IGO, which I'm sure Francis will cover during his presentation. He resides in Paris, but is going home after today's webinar back to Denmark. So over to you, Francis, and please take it away.
Thank you very much to all for joining us today, and thank you very much to Sealite for organizing these very interesting webinars. Thank you, Malcolm, and also Marianne, who could not be with us today, unfortunately. I really enjoyed the last one with Dave Leibold. It was fascinating, really nice. And you know, both Malcolm and Dave, they are well known in IALA. They are heavily involved in the work of IALA as Vice Chair and Chair of important working groups. And also the CEO of Sealite, Chris Proctor, is a member of the IALA Industrial Member Committee. And we actually like to call it the IALA family. It's really a family feeling in IALA, and it's a very big family now. I will come back to that. Today, I will talk a little bit about the history of IALA, the focus of the association, a little bit on some of the future challenges I see in the maritime sector. And then, as Malcolm mentioned to my little baby, the change towards becoming an intergovernmental organization. If you have worked with IALA for many years, most of it will probably be well known. I apologize, but maybe you could complement my presentation a little bit in the question and answer period with an anecdote or some proposals for IALA. That would be very, very nice. So, as you might know, IALA was IALA as an association was created in 1957, but actually the story starts much before that. During the Paris World Fair you know, the one where the Eiffel Tower was erected. You can see on the picture to your left. The French Lighthouse Authority hosted a conference on maritime works. And the conference actually created a permanent commission of conferences on maritime works. And about 10 years later, after the Paris World Fair, 10 years later, the permanent commission that was created and the Inland Navigation Conference, they merged into the Permanent International Association of Navigation Congresses. And that was called PIANC. And you probably know PIANC because that still exists. PIANC still exists, but with another name, but they kept the acronym PIANC. Then many things happened, of course. PIANC hosted five more congresses. And of course, we had First World War, and the World War left quite a lot of wrecks in European waters that need to be marked. At the conference hosted by PIANC, only one small session was devoted to age navigation. And that was at the time considered to be inefficient and not enough. And the group agreed to plan a conference completely dedicated to age to navigation with committees and plenary discussions, just as we know it today. In 1929, the first Lighthouse Conference was held in London, and it was hosted by Trinity House. And this first Lighthouse Conference is actually regarded as number one in the series of the IALA conferences. And that's why we, in 2 years in Rio, will host the 20th IALA conference, because the first one was already back in 1929. And the conference was organized by the country, the host country, but there was not a permanent secretariat at the time. So later in 1955, after the Second World War, and with the growing importance of the UN and the world's worldwide ambition that was created with the UN, it was decided to create a permanent secretariat, and in 1955 at the Lighthouse Conference, this task was given to the director of the Netherlands Lighthouse Authorities, and he actually succeeded the 1st of July 1957 to create this permanent secretariat that was called IALA, International Association of Lighthouse Authorities. And you see on the screen, you see the first constitution. It's not easy to see, but you see the first constitution, very short. Now it's a bit longer, but not much has actually changed. We still have the same aim, more or less, in IALA. So IALA was created the 1st of July, 1957. In 1958, the executive committee, that is now called the council, met for the first time. And the four gentlemen you can see on the picture there, we call them the founding fathers of IALA, was from France, the Netherlands, UK, and Germany. So IALA had only four members in 1958. So now, 63 years later, this is IALA today. Much has changed, really a lot. But as you know, the maritime sector is quite conservative. So we still have many things that are more or less the same as in 1957. The new constitution in Article 1 defines what we believe in IALA, and only in IALA, how we define an age to navigation. So I would like you to focus on three main things. The first is that in IALA, an age to navigation is a device, system, or service. So that can include, that includes, for instance, VTS and other services. And it's external to a vessel. And that makes us very different from the IMO, because the IMO mainly deals with the vessel itself, the construction, the seaworthiness, or the education of the crew, etc. But everything in IALA is external to the vessel. And the last word I would like you to focus on is efficient. So we enhance the safe and efficient navigation of these vessels. And I will say, if we go 10, 15, 20 years back, everything was about safety. But now a lot is about efficiency. After the economic crisis in 2007, everything changed to efficiency and actually money. So efficiency is now a main driver in the maritime sector. We have a motto and some principal aims. The motto is successful voyages, sustainable planet. We believe that our work makes navigation safer and create a successful voyage. And with a successful voyage, we help the planet being sustainable. And we also help the UN Sustainable Development Goals in IALA, of course. The three aims comes from the Constitution, is to harmonize standards, facilitate the safe and efficient movement, and to enhance the marine environment, the protection of the marine environment. We have now 314 members in today. We have 314 members. We had four members in 1958. So we have grown considerably since then. And we have three groups of membership. We have the national members, and those are national authorities in any country. We have the associate members, and those are scientific agencies, universities, pilot organizations. And then we have our very important industrial members, and those are manufacturers or consultants, et cetera, selling equipment, marine aviation navigation equipment. We have almost 160 industrial members at the moment, which is a record in the history of IALA. I think being an industrial members, the value for the industrial members are that IALA is the only technical organization for aviation navigation. And the industrial members, they create a long-standing relation with the decision makers and the customers, the aviation navigation authorities. They have unique access to the latest developments and best experts in the world. And they participate actively in the creation of the future for aviation navigation by being a member of IALA. We have a strategic vision. And the strategic vision has two goals. Goal number one is for IALA itself, you can say the mother organization. And again, I would like to focus on two words, developed and harmonized. And I think development and harmonization is the most important challenge for the future, actually. It's something I focus very much on. And if you look at this small picture here, you will see the development to your left. And you might know that IALA has been a very important partner in a lot of big projects in the maritime sector. We have the maritime buoyage system. For one, it's very, very important. We have been very important in the development of AIS, DGPS, VDES, LED, LED technology for aviation navigation, et cetera, et cetera. The training in VTS, many, many technical developments in VTS as well. So development is still extremely important in IALA. To your right, you will see a system where harmonization completely failed. If you travel around the world, you will know how many different electric plugs you will see in different countries. So this is definitely not harmonized. And in IALA, I normally say that we hate adapters. We don't want any adapters. We want the systems to be harmonized so that the mariner will see the same system all over the world, no matter where he goes. So this is two extremely important things for IALA. So how do we work? All the work is actually done in the technical committees, where Malcolm is a very important participant. We like to call it the powerhouse of IALA because they actually do all the work. And that's where the experts from all over the world meets. 100, 120, up to 150 people has met physically in the IALA headquarter two times a year for weeks of work in IALA. It's a standard program, really. It's a week, it's 5 days. The first day is plenary, 3 days of working groups, and the last day is the plenary, where the committee will agree on all the important documents they have produced. We have these four committees, the Astro Navigation Requirements and Management, Engineering and Sustainability, Vessel Traffic Services, and E-Navigation Information Service and Communication. They develop a little bit over time. Some years ago, we actually had an AIS committee, but that has now stopped because the development on AIS is more or less finished. So what do they produce, our committees? They harmonize world's Astro Navigation. And they do that, it's not very sophisticated, really. It's hard work producing documents that we publish on the website. And we produce standards, I'll come back to that, recommendations, which advise what should be done, guidelines, a much thicker document, which advise how to implement the recommendation as best practice. Manuals provide general reference material. You'll probably know the nav guide or the VTS guide. And then the committees, they produce model courses, which provide guidance on the training on VTS, Astro Navigation managers and technicians, mainly used by the Worldwide Academy and all the important training organizations all over the world. I mentioned the top level document, the IALA standard. We have 7 altogether. They were agreed for the first time at the General Assembly last time in Incheon. And actually they can only be changed by the General Assembly. So it's really the top level document of the association. A standard will list recommendations and tell the maritime authorities which one are normative and which one are informative. If you want to claim compliance with an IALA standard, you must implement all the normative recommendations. So this is a new document, only a couple of years old, and has proved to be extremely efficient, really. This was really the basic, the one leg of IALA, the old IALA, if I may say so, and the new leg is the Worldwide Academy. The Worldwide Academy was created in 2012, and it is an integral part of IALA. So the staff of the Worldwide Academy is also a member of the IALA Secretariat. It is administered by a dean, Omar Fritz Eriksson. I'm sure you all know Omar, of course. He's been with IALA for many, many years. And also a board chaired by Professor Guk from Korea. And here we have goal number 2 in the IALA strategic vision, because goal number 2 is for the Worldwide Academy. And you can see that the Worldwide Academy deals with all coastal states, not only the members, but all of them. I think there are about 155 altogether. And the goal of IALA, the strategic goal, is that all these coastal states have contributed to a sustainable and efficient global network of Astro Navigation through capacity building and the sharing of expertise. And the Worldwide Academy is doing this by enlighten, educate, and engage. They raise awareness all over the world in coastal states in need. They educate either themselves or through accredited training organizations. And very important, they pursue a long-term capacity building activities with the authorities, but also with, which is very important, also with individuals. We have a big list of individuals that we try to support and keep in contact with. So how do they decide on who to assist all over the world? Well, it's based on a very big analysis of all the 155 coastal states. We looked at the maturity of the Eastern Navigation Authority, the professionalism, the level of education, the legal implements in the work in the country, etc., etc. And then it's compared with the volume of traffic and the degree of risk from SOLAS, really. So if you have a maritime authority that is not so professional, but you have no ships, then it's not necessary to assist. But if you have a lot of traffic and a high degree of risk, then the country will be red. And it's very important to assist this country in adhering to the SOLAS requirements. So you can see on the map to your right that our focus is really Africa. Africa is the continent in need for the help and assistance of the Worldwide Academy. And that's where we focus our work at the moment. The Worldwide Academy will follow the UN motto, deliver as one. So we will actually try to make missions together with the IHO and the IMO in one team and deliver our services as one. The Enlighten, Educate, and Engage strategy. So this is the Worldwide Academy. It has been extremely successful since 2012. And we are very grateful to all our sponsors all around the world for the generosity that makes it possible to work. I will now turn very briefly to some challenges I see in the future, mainly linked to the digitalization, which is the buzzword for the future. And it's again, harmonized global solutions. It's so important to have harmonized global solutions because shipping is truly global. And we need to have global solutions. And especially in the digital world where the development is going extremely fast in the maritime sector. The best example of in IALA, I think, on a global harmonized solution is the Maritime Voyage Agreement. It's a beautiful solution because it is not a mandatory convention. It is simply a recommendation that all the countries in the world have chosen to follow of their own free will because it makes a lot of sense. And I think that's fantastic because normally these kind of things would be mandatory conventions, but this is simply a recommendation that everybody wants to follow. If you look at something that is fantastic in my view, but also a threat and a big, big challenge, I think, for the international organizations is all the regional test beds all over the world, because they create brilliant results, all these test beds, invest enormous amount of money and resources and with fantastic results, but they are often based on local or even company specific standards and solutions. And I think the main challenge for the international organizations is to combine these testbed results and make sure that they are harmonized globally based solutions. We don't want to create another electric plug solution with different voltage, different plugs, and lots of adapters. So this is really an important challenge for the world. If you how do we harmonize and how do we make these global solutions? Well, as I mentioned, it's not really very sophisticated work. It's hard work and it's paperwork. And it's done in the committees by the world's leading experts in our four committees. And you see here an example on how digital solutions and our other solutions is harmonized. We have these five types of documents. The top document is created in the International Maritime Organization, will be a maritime service description. And then we have the data product specification based on the IHO S100. Then we have a service specification based on IALA guideline, a service design description also based on a guideline, and a service instance description also based on another guideline. And when these five documents are created, and published and agreed internationally, then all the manufacturers and authorities can start to implement the globally harmonized solutions. We often refer this or compare this to kind of franchise companies. And I'm quite sure actually that McDonald's, they have a system like this, exactly the same system. So they can create a McDonald's that has a burger that has exactly the same size, color, taste, and price all over the world. So it's not a new thing, this, but we have to do it. It's hard work, but it's really, really important. And it's done in IALA and other international organizations. I mentioned the S100 because it's a building block in the harmonized digital solutions. And it's based on the IHO S100 system. The IHO is the owner of the whole system, and they take care of the S100 hydrographic descriptions. And IALA is the owner of S200. And we have already created and issued several S200 product specifications. And we will, of course, create more. Then we have S300, S400. I think the World Meteorological Organization is responsible for S400, et cetera, et cetera. And this is really the one of the building blocks for the harmonized solutions. We have created also an e-navigation underway series of conferences. You might know them. They have been there for 10 years now. And this will now change into a new concept called Digital at Sea, because we want these conferences to encompass all the digital solutions in the maritime sector. This is done with the Danish Maritime Authority and the Ministry of Ocean and Fisheries in Korea. And we have now an international conference in Denmark, we have an Asia Pacific conference in Korea, and we have a North American conference in US and in Canada. And there will be one every year, each year. And I hope they will start next year if the pandemic allows us. So I hope you will follow this and join the conference when it's announced. So I will now finish this small presentation by telling you a little bit about, I would call it the main project for IALA for the years to come. The change of IALA from a non-governmental organization to an intergovernmental organization. As you know, IALA has a long tradition of international work with other organizations. And IALA was one of the first organizations that achieved consultative status in the IMO. I think it was just a year after the creation of the IMO. And IALA is one of the senior members of the organizations with consultative status in the IMO. We also have a lot of memorandum of understandings with other organizations, and we work extremely close together with the IHO. We normally call them our sister organization. So we have a long tradition of this international cooperation. And if you remember the membership categories of IALA, it's a strange hybrid. IALA is really a very strange hybrid. I think no other organizations are like IALA, because we have the national authorities as our members. So the countries are actually members of IALA via the authority, but the government itself is not a member. So it's like a club for these national authorities. So it is quite a strange organization, really. And by creating this governmental organization, IALA will be just like the IMO, much smaller, of course, and less influence. But anyway, the organization of IALA will be the same. So if you look at this, how can I say, the main actors, international organizations in the maritime sector, you will see that IMO is without no doubt the regulatory organization of the maritime sector. Only IMO will create binding conventions for the world's country to follow. And the other organizations are non-binding. They create non-binding standards, recommendations, guidelines, and more importantly, or very important, they input their technical work to the International Maritime Organization, and then the International IMO will then take that into account in the binding conventions. And we have just seen that in IALA. We made all the work for the VTS resolution. It was created in IALA in the committee. It was sent to the IMO, and it will now hopefully be agreed at the assembly of the IMO next year and will be an IMO resolution based 100% on the work of IALA. So you have all these organizations working under the IMO and implementing their technical advice, giving the technical advice to the IMO. And as I mentioned, IHO is our most important sister organization, but we have others. You have the ITU, you have World Health, World Meteorological Organization, et cetera, et cetera. And all of these organizations, IALA is the only NGO. So we think it's important that IALA actually carry the same weight as the other main international organizations that implements their work in the IMO. And that's why it's extremely important that IALA change its status into an intergovernmental organization where the governments themselves, not the authorities, but the governments agree on the IALA papers. Many people have told me that it will be much more complicated in IALA. It will take longer time. There will be more discussion. It will be more bureaucratic. And I say, yes, I agree, but that is the price for influence. If you want influence on the developments, the worldwide developments in the maritime sector, it has to be complicated. Because if you have no influence, yes, then you can be very flexible and things will go fast. But as soon as you are influential, it will be complicated. So I say, yes, it will be more complicated. We will manage, but that's the price for influence. And we think actually that IALA has a lot to offer. So we are prepared to take the complication and influence the world to more safe navigation. I think that's what we're doing. It is very, very complicated to create an international organization. It's not something that is done very easily. It has taken more than 10 years now, and I have been part of it all the way. So we started the discussion in the legal advisory panel in 2010. I was actually the chairman at that time of the legal advisory panel. And then we started the negotiation with the French government immediately after. When the French government agreed, this is a good idea, we want to take this forward, we started to draft the convention text, which is quite complicated, and it took several years to draft the text. And then we had a very important resolution, General Assembly resolution in A Coruña, in the General Assembly in A Coruña in Spain in May 2014, where the IALA members actually passed this resolution directing the Secretary General and the Council to take this forward, that IALA wanted to shift to an IGO. That was really a milestone decision in 2014. And then we started the preparatory diplomatic conferences, the first one in Paris, 2017. And you can imagine 250 or 300 diplomats from 60 states discussing this 8 pages convention with all the implications forth and back, extremely complicated and long process. So we needed 3 preparatory diplomatic conferences in Paris, in Marrakesh, and in Istanbul before we were actually more or less in agreement with the text, convention text, so we could convene the last diplomatic conference in Malaysia in February this year with almost 300 participants from 62 states. And on the last day of that conference, 50 states signed the final act, which means that they had adopted the convention text that will eventually change IALA to an IGO. I've just heard from the French Minister of Foreign Affairs that the minister will sign the convention the first week of January, here immediately in the new year, and that the convention will then open for signatures by all interested member states of the United Nations. And when 30 states have signed and ratified the convention, IALA will then be an IGO. So I hope that can be done within the next couple of years. And with this, I thank you so much for your attention, for joining the webinar, and I will hand it back to you, Malcolm. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much indeed, Francis. Fascinating as ever. The question and answer session is open. We have had a couple of questions coming in, but if you want to put your questions in now, I'll get the ball rolling. We've had a question from Kevin Okananda. I think he's from the Congo. And his question is, when IALA obtain intergovernmental organization, will it be looking to extend its field of action towards internal waterways to promote fluidity of maritime goods?
I think the present IALA, the association we have now, the inland waterways are actually mentioned in the convention. So we can also work with inland waterways. That was deliberately taken out in the convention text of the new IGO, because inland waterways is a very national thing, and it's not really a subject for international harmonization altogether, because there are many national rules in the inland waterways as well. But globally, inland waterways are managed by a UN agency based in Geneva. I've been there a couple of times and giving them advice, because they base their ASU navigation on a publication called CIGNI. And CIGNI is based on the maritime buoyage system. Very cleverly, they have taken the maritime buoyage system and based CIGNI on that one. And every time we change the maritime buoyage system, we send the changes to this UN agency. So it is actually harmonized in a way. Mm-hmm. But inland waterway is a fantastic important means of transportation in Europe and in Africa and many other countries.
Very much so, very much so. And you look at the St. Lawrence Seaway and the Mississippi and the Congo, yeah, and the Rhine, you know, it's vital, important infrastructure. So I guess there's a bit of a follow-up from Kevin. He's asking, within the new organizational structure, what are IALA proposing to do for the future of African logistics, which I guess you kind of answered in your academy slides with those that most at needs. And presumably that'll continue with the outwork and the missions to Africa to help them.
Yeah, you saw that Africa is really our focus, and we really want to assist the African countries. And also Africa is a potential for IALA, because not very many African coastal states are member of IALA. So we would like to do more for Africa, actually, and try to recruit them and help them.
Now, there's a familiar name you'll be familiar with, Mr. Michael Bergman, who, yeah, I'm sure you know very well. You mentioned IMO that handle all the ship side, but on the port and shore side, we have a lot of multiple organizations, with IALA being one of the most important. How do you see the coordination? And I guess you kind of answered that in the slides. It came in before you'd got to that point, but is there any other points you'd like to make with regard to that?
Yeah, just a small point, and Michael Bergman knows that very, very well, but because the ports are also small individual economical entities, so it's quite complicated, because it's a business as well. A port is a big business, and I've discovered that lately, that it's not so easy to harmonize the ports, because many of them are private. Mm-hmm. and you need to create a business case as well before you can actually harmonize. So the harmonization needs also to be a good business case, which is an extra complication, but we have to look into that. And Michael has worked with IALA for a long time, and he has helped us and assisted us with many things. So we will rely on him with the port harmonization.
There you go, Michael. I hope that answers your question. Now, another familiar name, Juan Francisco Robeo, our good friend from Spain, ex-counselor. Hope he's enjoying his retirement. But he's asking, the last step for the change to RGO should be signed only by France in order to start the ratification time for countries. That should be communicated to the UN states by diplomatic or technical ways. I think he's asking how are you going to let everybody know once it's signed?
Malcolm, he was not only the counselor from Spain, he is a former president and honorary member. and fantastic support for the organization. And he's completely right, because this has to be done by the depositary, the French government. They have to inform all the member states of the UN, and they will do that by diplomatic note. That's how you do it, in the diplomatic channels. And that will go out here immediately in the new year. So all the member states of the United Nations will be invited to Paris and sign the convention that is open in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And during the pandemic here, I guess they can do it by the local ambassador. He can just make an appointment and come and sign the convention starting early next year. And that will be communicated by the French Minister of Foreign Affairs to all his counterparts in the world.
I have a question myself, actually. When IALA becomes IGO, do you foresee that it will start conducting audits of national members to ensure compliance?
It has been discussed, you know, many times, Malcolm. I'm not sure, because it is recommendation. It's not mandatory, so it's a bit strange to check compliance with recommendations. So I think that's for the IMO, really. I don't think IALA will do that in the near future, no.
Okay, very good. Well, with that being said, thank you very much again for giving us a fantastic presentation. I wasn't aware of some of those historical notes myself, even though I like to think I'm quite knowledgeable about it. A late one from Mike Bullock, of course. the importance of IALA on the international, it's more of a comment. With so much conflict across the globe, with the rise of nationalism and protectionism, IALA is a shining example of international cooperation. As an organization of technical experts, it's gratifying to see the collegiate working and friendship that overcomes politics and helps save lives to protect the entire environment. I couldn't agree with you more myself, Mike, but I'm sure Francis has a comment on that.
Oh, thank you very much, Mike and Malcolm. Could you send me that text on an email? I would like to use it for future presentation. It's wonderful. Thank you very much, Mike. Very good to hear.
Very good. Okay, Mason, I think we've got a slide to talk about our next webinar, which will be on the 21st of January. And we'll be very honoured to have Simon Milliard, who's the present chair of the IALA Engineering Committee from Trinity House. And he'll be wrapping up all of these webinars with a presentation on monitoring and asset management of ATON. So we've been through the whole gamut here. We've had all the risk assessments, the systems and maintenance, the recommendations and guidelines. And then Simon will be talking about how you monitor and do your asset management plans of ATON. So that'll wrap up the series very nicely. And we are looking to do some more later on in the new year. So keep your ears peeled. Thank you very much for all the attendees. And thank you again to Francis. And if you can spare 60 seconds after the end of this webinar to fill in a short survey, that will be greatly appreciated. So thank you very much for your attendance, and I wish you all a very good evening, good morning, and stay safe and healthy. Thank you very much.